So just giving an update here. I've made it around. I'm climbing up around the base of Mount Hood right now. It's right up here in the background, and really spectacular sight. Alpine country up here, big country. You know, I'd love to climb to the top of that, but I think I might save that for another day. Right now, trail kind of takes me around the edge of it, and basically right now I'm about 50 miles from the border of Washington, so that feels good. A little bit of a milestone coming up, and it's kind of pushing me along right now. So I've been traveling most of the day around Mount Hood, and I've been getting views of it. You can kind of see it off there in the distance a little bit. It's a beautiful day. Clouds are just actually coming around the mountain, so I feel like I'm in a good spot heading north. I've got about 33 miles to go to get to Washington border, so that's a pretty awesome feeling. And beautiful. I'm looking forward to the next section because it's supposed to be a little bit wetter zone, lower elevation, more kind of rainforesty, as it's sometimes described. And all in all, it's been a great journey. I've been learning a lot. Very humbling, for sure. Very humbling. And yeah, I'm glad I'm this far right now. That's all I could say. And thanks for sticking with me on this journey if you've been following us. So I'm getting really close to Washington. You can see back background there, there's I believe that's Mount Jefferson. And I'm high on life today. It's pretty amazing being up here. You get these beautiful days like this, and you know, just a while back we had some blistering cold windy days, and it's amazing. You know, what an experience to be able to walk across a state on a trail by your feet. I mean, come on, that's like unbelievable. And I'm getting ready to drop in this lush valley down here. There's it's supposed to be a little bit more kind of a wetter zone, but I mean, I don't see any mist or anything today, but I'm looking forward to more greenery, being by the creek, and yeah, spectacular. Can I say, this has been amazing. As you can see now, I'm quickly dropping and the terrain is changing. It's getting a lot more lush down here. It's actually beautiful. I love the views up on the top, but this is nice to get down lower elevations. A bit more humid, warmer down here. And yeah, another aspect of this trail changes from 1 mile to the next. So right down here, I've got some Oregon grape, and this one doesn't have the berries on it, but there's a bunch growing around here. So let me pull this up so you can see it. So here it is. One big identifier with it is it does have prickly leaves that are basically opposite of each other. And the other thing, the other characteristic about it is if you scrape off the bark, you get this really vibrant yellow color. So if you take these roots, you pound it up, doesn't take a lot of them, but pound it up, you make a nice tea out of it. And this is a really good liver tonic. It's an anti-parasitic, it's a mild cleanse, and it just makes an overall nice tea. So Oregon grape. So just dropped down to lower elevations, coming into Cascade Locks. Evening's approaching. You see it's quite green, beautiful, lush around here, which is a welcome change. It's humid, it's a bit warmer, moist, almost feels a little tropical in here. And so right now I'm just looking for a place to camp for the evening. Set up, I brought a slightly different get up tonight, which I'll show you that, give you some ideas on traveling light if you want to do more of the overnight pack-in running style trips. So yeah, stay posted for that, and yeah, we'll see you soon. All right, so I just found a camp for the evening, and as I said before, I was going to show you some different ways to travel ultralight if you're more of a pack runner. And I'm really liking the Fast Pack 20 by Ultimate Direction. I've used it quite a bit during this trip. And so tonight, what I want to show you is I kind of moved away from the tarp for this last little bit and show you a little bit more how I used to travel in terms of a sleep setup. And what I have in here is, well, there's some miscellaneous stuff, clothes, and there's a sleep pad here. And I brought with me a bivy sack. Now this is a new bivy sack for me. It's an outdoor research. It's called the Helium Bivy, and it's very lightweight. Weighs less. I know it weighs less than a pound and a half. I'd have to check exact weight. But the bivy has been a go-to for me. Before I moved out to Utah, in my teenage years, I used to run all over the Sierras and parts of California, and I carried a little bag with a bivy sack and sometimes a down sleeping bag, and that was a great combination. And then later on, as I got more into survival skills, I pushed myself more and more, and I just started carrying my stuff bundled up in a little cloth, rolled up, tied around my waist, and I'd always put a bivy sack in there to keep me out of the elements. Now, the nice thing about a bivy sack is that there's not really much setup to it. It's kind of down and dirty, survival lead type thing, and basically its advantage to a bivy sack is that you can sleep almost anywhere. You can actually fit in spaces that maybe a tarp or a tent can't fit into, and that's what I really like about it. So if you're into more of the scout style camping and you just want to unroll something and nestle into some leaf somewhere, this is your ticket. And so the bivy sack, it's made out of waterproof but breathable material, and what that means is that the vapor from your body is gonna basically push through the fabric and it won't be soaking wet inside as much as just rolling up in a tarp. So this particular bivy, like I said, it's brand new. It comes with a set of poles which you can use or not. I probably won't use them tonight because the weather is actually really nice. But that's really all there is to it. It's just basically a bag. And let me get a little closer so you can see some of the details here. So it's a bag that your sleeping bag can go inside of. And you unzip it here. And most bivvies, or I should say a lot of them, come with mosquito netting, which is a really nice feature. If you just get in a buggy zone, you can keep that up. And then undo that mosquito netting. And then you're ready to throw in your pad, sleeping bag, whatever. So I'm still using the X Light pad. It's really nice because it's super light, and I have my my mountain hardware sleeping bag here. This pad's crazy how fast it is to blow up. Then you got this little pump to give it a little extra pressure. That's good right there. Undo the sleeping bag. I've got the sleeping bag, plus I keep a silk liner in there too, which is nice because then your skin's not directly on the nylon. And I add some more too. So I'll go ahead and throw the pad in there first. And we'll toss the sleeping bag in there. And finally the silk liner, which you kind of got to wiggle in there a little bit. And that's the gist of the basic bivy without the pole setup. Now, when you get inside a bivy like this, there's two types of bivy sacks I've seen that are really common. One is envelope style, where this basically wraps over you kind of like a hood. The other one, I call it sort of entering the mouth of a fish, because you kind of close it up and it can go over the top of you if the weather's bad. I tend to like this style. Outdoor Research is very keen on it. And the nice thing about it is you can string it up if weather's bad, but great thing is when it's nice like this, you just keep it open, sleep under the stars, get a lot of fresh air, and enjoy it. Now, if you do want to set up the pole, so basically you just take it, there's a little sleeve inside here, and you're going to slide it through the sleeve to the other side. It's very simple. And then undo that. And then when you pull this over you at night, it gives you a little lift, a little space. So you can see that's actually quite a bit better if you're gonna get rained on. There's also a loop here. So a lot of times I used to not use the pole and just string it up with the loop. That's also an option, but this is so light now with the pole, the way they design it. You can stake it out as well to get some tension on there if you don't want the fabric on you. So yeah, this is a great bivy. So that's the setup there. It is getting late, but I'm gonna go ahead and make some barberry tea that I collected, and do some stretching, get a good night's sleep. So good morning. I'm just running down the canyon here, and last night was beautiful, listening to the creek right by my camp, and the bivy sack that I used worked out awesome. I really love that setup. Like I said last night, that bivy sack's new for me, but I used to own one identical to that one, just it was made out of a heavier material. So this is cool. It brings back that design that I love in a very ultralight package. Last night I said about a pound and a half, but I would venture to say it's just slightly over a pound, especially if you were to leave a pole behind. This canyon, unbelievable. I mean, I'm seeing lots more waterfalls. It's very tropical down here. It's early morning, but it's very humid and moist. It feels really nice. And I'll be at the Washington border in just a few hours if all goes well. So I'm just getting close to the Washington border. I'm actually walking along the interstate right now on a paved path. This is part of the alternative route. The interstate's right up here. That last section was amazing. I went through beautiful canyon, tons of waterfalls. I felt like I was in the tropics or New Zealand or something. It was amazing. Yeah, it's been incredible. So any minute I should see Sarah running down this trail. I just gave her a call and yeah, so hopefully see her soon. There's Sarah, my lovely Sarah. We just made it into Washington. We crossed Bridge of the Gods, which is, according to Indian folklore, is actually a natural bridge at one time, but now it's just a constructed car bridge. So that was quite interesting. It was quite a cap for finishing up the state to be next to this highway on this big bridge. It's kind of loud around here. It's quite a contrast from just a couple hours ago seeing all these big waterfalls and being up on Pacific Crest Trail. It's been an incredible journey for me so far to go across the whole state of Oregon all on, you know, a national scenic trail. It's like just unbelievable, and to do it with my partner too, to share that experience. And I've definitely learned a lot more from it than just doing it alone. By having done this together, I feel like it's that much more potent. You know, it's something that, you know, we have a connection with, and it's been incredible to document it too, because you know, our friends and family are excited about it, and you know, hopefully fans as well will appreciate what we're doing. It's been tough. As people have been following the journey, as you know, early on I injured my knee, and it's just an unfortunate thing that happened. I was coming around a corner with the camera and kind of hit a little bit of a loose pebble, and I felt a twinge in my tendon below the kneecap, but I was like, ah, I'm tough, I'll just keep going and grind it out. But it hurt, and we had to take about 8 days off, but it never really fully healed. So at this point, I would say I'm more like at 80% rather than 90%, and we're behind in schedule. So we decided we're gonna break it up into two parts and come back for the Washington part. It's a lot of mixed emotions. I'm sad about leaving the trail, but I also, you know, I value running so much, and I value my knee more than my pride. And so that says a lot. And right now I feel like we're behind schedule, and I need to take care of my body and just get back to it. You know, get my knees strong so I can continue doing adventures like this, because this isn't going to be the last. So I appreciate everybody for sticking with us and being a part of this journey, and it's been awesome. I hope you guys have enjoyed it as much as we have.